everyone, and welcome to Manch Talk. I am Tammy Simmons Garthwaite.
And I'm Carla Garrick, I'm pretty sure.
Well, it's funny, my friend Marion Ward is, she bought me a ticket to Liberty Forum for the weekend, or gave me tickets, right? And she goes, so I'm on your badge, she goes, so is your name hyphenated? And I go, actually, my name is just Tammy Garthwaite. But that seems to confuse people. So, and she was like, oh.
See, now I feel like you actually, for the first time, understand my struggle with the pronunciation of my name,
Because it happened again. Yeah, it's just weird. And I'm like, oh. And so then I went on to explain that, if anything, even though this isn't actually my name, I usually, if I'm filling something out, like a form on the computer, I'll put Tammy Simmons as my first name. And then Garthwaite as my last name, so that Dan and I are on the list at the same place. Okay, I don't know what I still don't know.
I mean, and I don't have a middle name, but of course my last name is impossible to say. And I worked so hard at being like, just say Garrick and don't confuse it. And then Monday night, I think I did Larry Sharp show.
Okay.
Out of New York City. I'll probably make that my Carla Garrick show for this week. And he asked, you know, before the show, we were doing pre-stuff, and he goes, how do you say your name? And I go, Garrick. And you could tell, like, he paused really long, and it was not computing or anything. And I was like, well, it's Garrick, but no one can say that. And he was like, oh, that makes more sense, but also I'm going to say it the other way.
Right. It's just what is. That's what's funny, too. I don't know what made Dan read this in something. I think he was reading me something in Reason, probably in the back of Reason where they have those short little things.
Yep.
And he was saying how one of the provinces in Canada has ruled that businesses with 25 or more employees or something must conduct business in French. And I go, oh, yeah, that's Quebec. Quebec's been doing this for, you know, probably 20, 30 years now. Yep. And Dan's like, right, but that's what? Like, and I go, yeah, I said... He goes, it's fine to say we're encouraging businesses to do business in French because they are a French prop. You know, that's they're French speaking first. But to mandate it, I'm like, yeah, Canada mandates all sorts of things.
No, the thing is, so the world has gone mandate crazy, right? Because someone was like, oh, maybe this will make it easier. If we just force people to do things, then, hey, life will be easier. No. So it turns out, I don't know if you're keeping score on team conspiracy theory.
Yeah, we're
but I'm about like 100.
Well, I mean,
100 plus.
The thing,
currently,
who were we watching this weekend? We were watching. I think it might have been just on Tucker Carlson, and they had this Chinese woman who they had on at the very beginning talking about like, look, this is what I do for a living, and I looked at Dan and I go, I literally remember. Before it was even a pandemic, before it was even like remotely in the United States, we were watching, I don't remember why, but I don't know if we're watching it on Russia Today, like who knows, right? And they were talking about how there was this outbreak of the virus in this little tiny town, and you know, there's this lab, and I remember we were like, okay, that's not a coincidence. You know? And that was like in January or February before it was even a thing. And
It's kind of like, you know, Lyme disease, which is something we have up here in New England. It's a tick-borne disease, or so they claim.
It's government created.
So Lyme, you know, Lyme disease is so named because the first case they found was in Lyme, Connecticut. But it was an entire coincidence that the U.S. has a bio lab the river of where Lyme, Connecticut is.
Did
and I'm sure
ever
that's
listen
just
to the podcast about Lyme? The whole there's an
so it turns out I read today ivermectin works for Lyme disease.
Well,
in case you didn't know that, yeah, it's turning out that ivermectin might be this like miracle drug that big pharma was trying to hide, and now
aspirin. Aspirin would like works for all sorts of things,
right?
You know?
But now they're kind of going. You know, they overplayed their hand to bring this back to mandates. I mean, one of the things that's actually coming out, and just for folks back home who are keeping score, because I'm keeping score. You know why I'm keeping score? Not just because I want to say I told you so. But you know I do. But also because I think it's important for people to look at what happened and start to go, Okay, like, one, why did these people get it right and I didn't? And two, maybe, just maybe, we should be listening to these people about a myriad of things, because maybe we're actually right about the other things too.
Realize, like, and this is that's a very big example of what I'm about to say, but it goes in so many different things. I've realized over the past couple of years how little people can think for themselves, like, can actually process just thought process, like normal deduction. The one that was not a tough subject, but yesterday or the day before, there was the guy who shot the other guy outside the goat restaurant, right? And his defense attorney, they put in a plea of self-defense. Now, I don't know all the details.
And alcohol,
right?
Willing to bet you good money.
But even still, all of it. All the details are completely irrelevant when it comes to everybody talking about it, because I was amazed at how many people just were like, the judge is right. And I'm like, the judge doesn't get to judge. The judge just makes sure that the law, that the Constitution, like the process, the jury is who judges. And like, I was like, you all know this, right? That there's this jury of your peers. And then...
Well, it depends. And it isn't always the case anymore.
No, it isn't. Well, they plead things out. But I'm saying, but it's still... In theory,
no, and a lot of cases don't actually go to jury trials anymore. That's one of the real distortions of the justice system.
Then it was interesting because the people in one personal comment, and then everybody snowballs, and I'm like, can I just clarify? So they're talking about legal self-defense claims, right? Like
we just use the same one that the AG uses for the police. They feared for their lives.
That was an interesting thing.
We're lucky. Then it's fine. So it's totally subjective.
Somebody said, well, we have a stand your ground law, but it's only on private property. And I had to doubt myself because I was like, no. So I Googled just to make sure. Nope. New Hampshire has a stand your ground law.
And a castle doctrine.
Anywhere you have the right to defend yourself.
Anywhere you have a right to be.
It used to only be on your property. But now that we have that. So if this was self-defense, and it's funny because I'm thinking, I never said it was self-defense. I'm saying he has a right to a jury by his peer. And self-defense is this. Can be, like, stop making up the laws as you go along. So it was just funny how, like, you just start to wonder, like, can people not...
Tammy, so I saw a bell curve the other day on intelligence, right? And, and we've talked about this before, because it turns out, I think a lot of the environmental stuff that we're doing that is damage to ourselves, mm-hmm. and a lot of neurological damage. So I actually do think people are, sorry to break the news, getting dumber. But we know the fluoride in the water, which on average stops one cavity, makes everyone 5 points dumber. Yeah. So thank God I grew up in a place that didn't have fluoride
in the
water.
We had fluoride in the water either.
But be that as it may, the dummies down here and then the super smart people over here, right? So your IQ above 135, I think above 140 might be genius level actual defense. I mean, that's 0.02, I forget. But it's less than 1% of the entire world's population. They are not all on Twitter and on social media. In fact,
And I know you've butt heads with them, but did the whole thing with Scott Adams.
Poking the bear.
But the story, I was like, what? So I actually printed it out because I'm like, I have to keep this one out. Because if you don't know, so Scott Adams is the guy who draws Dilbert.
Right.
Which is syndicated and blah, blah, blah.
Well, so, was.
Right. It's been pulled from all the newspapers. And you're probably wondering, well, why would that be? Because he literally referenced a Rasmussen poll where they asked two questions. The one was, do you agree or disagree with the statement? It's okay to be white. Okay. And his point was 53% of black people said no. Well, that is concerning that
more than half
of a minority population doesn't even think it's okay to be, like, if you said to me, is it okay to be black? I'd be like, I don't care if you're black.
Right, but what does that mean? Is it okay to be white? Like, I feel like this entire poll was set up whole world matter.
The second question, though, was, they were just trying to say, like, can black people be racist?
Of course black people can be racist. And anyone who says they can't does not understand racism. Racism is if you discriminate against another group based on the color of their skin.
But
everyone can be racist.
Exactly.
Chinese people can be racist. Tammy can be racist. I don't know if you are.
Totally.
White people,
racist.
Black people, brown people. Everyone can be racist. And you know what? If people are honest, everyone's a little bit racist because everyone is like
your life is
informed by who you are,
right? So it was interesting because
I was actually quoting a Avenue Q joke in case the entire internet of Dilbert can get canceled. I'm probably next.
That's what I mean. I was like, so wait a minute, they're going to cancel a cartoon about Office just funny because the guy who draws the cartoon didn't say,
I like to think if Scott Adams apologized to me, which I asked him again today in a tag post, maybe all these woes will go away.
Yeah, I don't think
so. You know, because
I'm
like,
you have that much power.
No,
it's just a bizarre.
No, I'm joking, obviously.
I'm just saying, it's so bizarre, though. Like,
no, I'm just like, I think what's happening is these people, it befells them. We saw this years ago, right? So if someone's an influencer or someone's like, oh, I have this platform, then it's an actual addiction, right? So there's a dopamine reaction that happens for the hits, right? So you actually become addicted to that.
Yep.
In the same way you would get addicted to crack or fentanyl or whatever. And then they have to keep escalating their message in order to get the attention, to get the hits. And so my half joke with Scott is, so he needs to break his own addiction cycle because he's clearly escalated to the point where he's now lost his job.
Or
right?
Part of his job, that job.
You know, or maybe he can
it would continue. I'm trying to remember. He did say it'll continue. It'll be not on Odyssey. What's the other platform?
Rumble?
I don't remember. Some platform. It'll still be on platform. And if you are a whatever, you know, if you pay into his supporter, you will get it like all the time.
And I'm actually talking karmically, right?
No,
like
I know.
These people are doing these things. And I'm like, you know what? Because someone said it again today because Hot Tip Jesus on Twitter posted, and I guess he had Scott on his podcast yesterday. And, you know, first of all, I bet you Scott Adams, not a racist.
No.
He was making a legitimate point. Of course, you're not allowed to talk about
You can't even say something like, holy cow, they polled these people. I mean, it was only 1,000 people, so 53% of what? Like, to me, I was like, first thing I did was, I couldn't find the actual content, which was frustrating. I was able to find some summaries, but I'm like, but where's the one with the actual breakdown? And it was only 1,000 people, and Dan did have a good point, and this is going to show how non-racist I am. He goes, well, it's probably not a fair survey. And he goes, because there's probably a higher proportion of black men in prison who probably weren't surveyed than there are out of, and I was like, you got a good point. Like, you're not surveying the entire population when a larger, the propensity of people in our prison system tend to be black males, not only because maybe they committed more crimes, but they don't get the same level of justice often that somebody else does. Anyways.
But here's the question. Everything. Back to why were we right on things? And this actually ties into Scott as well, right? Because then he said, he actually said, no, the people who are right on all the conspiracy theories, lab leak theory, masks don't work, school closures are going to screw up the children.
All the things.
Natural immunity is an actual thing that has existed since, you know, the Athenian plague in whatever it was, like 400 BC, and then for 3 years we forgot what it was, and then we made a comeback, and now, like, science prevails again. So people like him, right, like, they were wrong, and so he said the only reason you guys were right is because you're skeptical of government. So I'm like, okay,
maybe
that is actually the starting point for at least half of how I think about this.
It makes us go, I don't know.
But also, skeptical right. about government. And it's because we've learned our lesson. Like, you can only get punched in the face so many times when you either go, this person is garbage and I don't want to be around them, or you're like, okay, I got to be a victim and abused for the rest of my life. So I choose not to be abused by my government. And that has stood me in really good stead. Yep. And it's George Carlin who said, right, I'll believe anything the government says to me. Neither do I. Turns out Nordstrom also right. Yeah. So turns out lab leak.
Oh, the lab leak. I mean, that was just
a puzzle. So the Department of Energy just came out, and that was a whistleblower. I didn't actually realize. So over the weekend, it's a leaked report that came out from the Department of Energy.
Yes.
And they were like, yeah, we think a lab leak seems likely. They said they have low confidence, was the quote, in it. But the fact that they're actually admitting that it is. So today, the FBI said also, well, we've known for some time.
Some time now, like 3 years.
You know, again, you know, if you're looking where to place your trust, perhaps not the groups of people who keep lying to you.
Speaking of being punched in the face by government.
Yes.
Here in Manchester, they're doing a good job of continually trying to punch us in the face. I did bring two things from recent newspaper. I think we'll talk about this one first because it'll be faster, maybe. There was an article.
Like a train.
Yeah. Article in the paper on the 26th. So what's that? Must have been Sunday's paper. So remember that all the rail, they keep talking about rail. We keep spending money on studies. And
how much money have they spent on those studies? It's got to be almost $40 million
It's an insane amount of studies. But this is the kicker. Now they're saying to restore commuter rail, like we had commuter rail yesterday or something, from Boston through Manchester would cost $782 million to build and $17 million every year to operate. Well, I'm like, holy cow. But even that, they said that just Manchester alone would have to spend at least $200,000 a year just to operate the station after it's built and after. And all these people, again, the
you
people.
You mean like this great bus station they operated over here?
The people in this discussion, they're like, oh, it would be great to have a train to take into Fenway. And I'm like, then you pay for it.
It would be great to have a train. I want a train to Boston. But no, and I'm willing to pay for it if I have to pay for it. Buy a ticket. But should the people in the North Country have to pay because Tammy and Carla would like to go hang out in Boston more often?
That's insane. That is not a need. That is a want.
Two facts that everyone needs to know. One is no train that they've ever built.
Ever.
Since the 1800s when they broke it. Monopoly busted the train guys. No train has ever made a profit in America. So then the question becomes, if the government's like, we must build this because then people will use it, and then no one uses it, maybe you should listen from the start and not spend $1 billion making another mistake.
And they say already... COVID, as if it's going to bounce back because people are working from home, that ridership is already down like 58%. So let's build more. So that's the first punch. Boom, that got us in that side of the head. Then on the other side of the head, how's that school budget looking for you? So the school board, I'm going to do some preface numbers. It's important.
All right. I'm ready to get punched in the face.
In 5 years' time, we have 1,600 fewer students than from 5 years ago.
Okay. So, yeah. Okay.
Just keep that in mind. We're educating 1,600 fewer students than just 5 years ago. Well, the Manchester School Board, in their infinite wisdom, put forth a budget of $191.75 million to educate, 12,000 kids.
Okay, which works out to what, about 18,000 per kid?
I didn't want to even do that because that was going to make it. But the thing that people have to remember is they will spend every penny they can get their greedy little hands on. The tax cap allows for 4.96% because inflation, because everything else is already expensive.
Because of egg prices.
Guess how much they'll spend? 4.96 more.
Oh, yeah.
Even though there's fewer students.
Oh, yeah.
Now, we could talk about, the budget and how it doesn't work. It's just a couple highlights, because, Salary increases, $1.5 million in salary increases, $1.5 million in additional employee benefits, $4.5 million in reductions for transportation services, and I can't even figure out what that means.
Less bus drivers.
Then, on top of that budget, they did another budget that's even higher at $192.75 million, which is the additional needs budget, because there's more than they need in the 5% increase isn't enough for all their needs. The kicker, the big kicker in this one, $2,173,236. It's a lot. For equity.
What?
Because we need $1.7 million in staff, and we need $230,000 for community partnership, and then we need $200,000 for the programmatic buildup.
I will give you a programmatic buildup.
You know, if we're going to talk about the school budget, because, you know, like, okay, so teachers get raises, and I'm not saying teachers shouldn't get raises, and there is...
Actually, out of all the things we could spend the money on, I'd be happy to give teachers raises.
I'm saying so...
Let's fire all the administrators
there could be
in return. Who's with me?
5% cost of living. You know, yep. There is an added cost to running the schools. If we were comparing apples to apples, we're talking many fewer students. And I'm like, so how bad?
How bad?
How bad?
How bad?
Because you know what? We have 3+ public high schools.
Okay.
We have
West.
We've had, as long as I've ever been in Manchester or New Hampshire, we have West Central Memorial and we have the Tech High School.
High school.
So I went back to like whatever I could grab easiest in 2007. So that's 15 years ago, right?
Wow.
So that, but I'm saying, but that's not so crazy ago.
No, but still, it feels like it was the other day.
In 2007, I believe we only had 3 high schools. I don't think the Tech High School was more than a couple, you know, a handful of students.
Okay.
There were 6,095 high school students in those 3 schools.
Wow.
Okay.
Okay, and now we have 16,000, you said?
No, this is just high school.
Oh, okay.
Just because we have one too many high schools. We all know it.
Everybody knows it.
We now have 3,630 kids in like 4 high schools. Okay, everybody.
Why?
If you have a family of 5 and you have 3 vehicles, and your children grow up and leave... And there's only 2 of you left. You don't keep the 3rd vehicle. You generally get rid
downsize.
Of it. You go down to what you
actually
need.
It's what everyone else does.
We're like
government. Tell me one thing that has ever shrunk. The government. Like one thing. Actually, what's our email address?
Manchtalk@gmail.com. Send me any
or comment on the Facebook. One thing.
Anything.
I'm like literally.
Well, what shrunk is the availability of the dump being opened and things like that.
Yeah. Services
shrink, but the growth of government never seems to go away. And the fact that we're like at 60% of the kids from 15 years ago, but we have a 4th high school now. There's like,
and the budget's got to be like triple,
oh my god! And
right?
If you look at the kids, I'm not sure if it was in probably a paper I had at home, but you look at it and you go, it is blatantly obvious when you look at the number of students in these schools. If we were able to do it with almost 6,100 kids just 15 years ago, how can we not do it?
Can we also say, and this is really important because this actually is one of the things that comes up a lot when we're discussing school choice. We're spending more money.
Yep.
But we're getting worse results.
Yes.
And that is the turning point where it is absolutely unacceptable. How can we be spending $20,000 per student, let's say for this, I'm just
going to
make up numbers now, $20,000. 15 years ago, we were spending $8,000. And in those 15 years, the competency rate for reading and math it's under 30%.
It's not okay.
For Manchester. So the question becomes, who's getting all this money? And I will tell you who it is. It is bureaucrats. It's control freaks. It is red tapers. It is all the NGOs and government offices and nonprofits that have all arisen in the same way as when we talk about the poverty industry and the homelessness industry, where you end up, now you're paying millions of dollars in salaries to people, but not for people to solve the problem of homelessness, because homelessness is not getting less, it's becoming more.
Or
that kids can read. And
but we're going to have an equity plan, so they'll all be
equitable. But everyone will be fairly stupid. Fist bump.
all we have for this week. By all means, give us an example of things in government that you think actually have gone down over the years. Manchtalk@gmail.com or comment in the on the Facebook thread. And we will be back next week, Wednesdays at 1.
Okay, and I want to give a quick shout out for people who are curious about the Free State Project. Yeah. There's this fantastic new series on NBC Boston. It's called Life, Liberty, and the Pursuit of New Hampshire. I will be live on NBC Boston next Tuesday to talk about it. So in the meanwhile, go watch them. I think there's eight of the
I'm
episodes
only, I think,
are
through
up.
Four or something.
And I think they give you actually a pretty fair insight into who and what we are.
That's right.
All right.
That's all we got.
Bye, guys.
Bye.